Welcome.
So this is lecture recital, which is a little bit different than the other recitals here on campus. I'm going to be talking a lot of the time. And this is the guy I'm going to be talking about a little bit later on. The title of my document, my thesis. The document in the piano in the big band, Kapustin's Variations, Opus 41. But we're going to kind of approach this from a little bit more of a roundabout way. First of all, we're just going to kind of talk about a general question. So what should the piano sound like? The piano can sound like a lot of things. It can sound like a full orchestra. Or it can sound like a voice, the human voice. Or it can sound like a rock band. That's Muse, Time's Running Out. It's a great song. So the piano can imitate and mimic a lot of different things, and this is kind of what I'm going to be talking about. Specifically, I'm going to be talking about the relationship between, first of all, the piano and the orchestra. I'm going to read a couple quotes, a little section of my paper. An accolade many have given great pianists over the years is that their playing sounds like a full orchestra. Scriabin's pupil, Nemanova Loon, said of Scriabin's playing, "At the touch of his fingers, the ugly walls, the poor furnishings, the discordant piano, all disappeared, and a mighty orchestra resounded." Liszt said of the piano, "Perhaps the mysterious influence which binds me to it so strongly prejudices me, but I consider the piano to be of great consequence. In my estimation, it holds the first place in the hierarchy of instruments. In the compass of its seven octaves, it includes the entire scope of the orchestra, and the 10 fingers suffice for the harmony which is produced by an ensemble of 100 players." So now I'm going to show you and kind of further this question by looking at a masterclass. This is Daniel Barenboim talking about Beethoven sonatas.
You asked him if at some point he could orchestrally begin to imagine some of the phrases. Do you think that would be helpful in terms of approaching a piece like this, to imagine the flutes in one part, the bass in another?
I think that this is something that can be helpful in any piece you play on the piano, because the piano, like this, you know, is a very primitive, neutral instrument. Any way to put on the key produces a sound. Look. The C sharp, not particularly interesting when I do the elbow. You could put an ash there, anything you could do that. You try and do that on the violin. You get nothing. You have to first find a note, then you have to know how to put the finger, then you have to know how to connect the two hands, then you have to decide something before you can actually make the equivalence of that. Therefore, the piano is, from that point of view, a very neutral element. And it is precisely this neutrality which gives it the possibility of so much expression. Because you can put on the neutral wall any color you want. You cannot put any colors you want on the wall that already has a color, blue, red, whatever it is. And the neutrality of the piano is what gives it the possibility to be so expressive. But in order to do that, you have to accept the fact that in itself, left to its own devices, it is a very neutral, inexpressive instrument, but that it is open to 20 million different ways of seduction of each finger. And then you get that. And therefore, if you have in your ear the sound of the oboes, or the sound of the violin, or the sound of the chorus, or the sound of the flute, it doesn't have to be that had Beethoven orchestrated it, he would have put the flute. The mere fact that you have that in your ear and you have a sensitivity and an understanding of how the flute sounds in that register will allow you, if you have the necessary manual control, to produce a sound that is much more interesting and more imaginative than the sound that is produced by simply bringing the keys down.
Okay. So a couple points, just to recap. Oh, let me get in. They asked him if a pianist should begin to imagine an orchestra or the different sounds of an orchestra. And this is something that I experienced a lot of different times with all my teachers. They would say, imagine that that low sound, that low figure that you're playing in the bass is a cello, or that this is percussion. And it's not so much that that anyone in the audience would be fooled into thinking that the pianist is playing a violin, but by beginning to just imagine those instruments and the communications of those different instruments that happen in an orchestra, you can create different kinds of sounds. So I had demonstrated in the beginning how the piano can sound like a voice, how it can sound like a rock band, and that is because of the neutrality that he talks about. And it can sound like many different things and should sound like many different things. So that being said, let's explore for a second pictures at an exhibition. This is a piece written by a Russian composer, Mussorgsky, and basically he went through an art exhibit and wrote pieces for the piano based on each painting that he saw. So this is the one we're going to focus on. This is the Ballad of the Unhatched Chicks. Ballad of the Chicks and Their Shells. It's translated a couple different ways. Not a great painting, but I think the score is a little better. But anyway, the image that you get when you're listening to this is a bunch of chickens kind of hatching from their shells and running into each other. It's very cute. And I'll show you the score for the piano, which looks like this. While we listen to a performance. So Mussorgsky wrote this, and it was written for solo piano. A lot of different people took this score and set it to an orchestra, set it to a full orchestra. The one that is most famous and most well-known that we're going to talk about is Ravel's. And basically, it's just a discussion and kind of a question of what instruments would you put to cover each of these parts. So I'll tell you, because the score is kind of hard to read, but Ravel has the flutes take these grace notes. They're on the on beat, and the flute is high and kind of demands our attention early on. And then he has the bassoon and the viola play this eighth note line. And if you listen, I'm going to show you the piece in a second. If you listen to the score for orchestra, this cuts through the texture, and then the grace notes become the background. The grace notes here are played by the oboe. So by kind of, and the oboe doesn't stick out in the texture as much as the flutes do. So anyway, if you're a pianist and you are familiar with this orchestration, you should try and make these grace notes cut out, bring out and pop out of the texture more. And then when you come here, make these have a little bit darker sound going to the background. So I'll show you what the... orchestral. This is what the orchestral score looks like. So we have the flutes taking the grace notes in the beginning, the oboes taking it here, and the bassoon and the viola playing. And it sounds like this. Thank you. So anyway, to conclude with pictures in an exhibition, we have grace notes in both sections, but Ravel gives these grace notes a different instrument and therefore a different color, and the color doesn't pop out as much. So if you're a pianist and playing, if I was teaching this piece or playing this piece, I would think about that. I would think about how I want these notes to be sharper, cut out of the texture more, and how I want these notes to go into the background while this takes over. So I think that's kind of what Barenboim is referring to. So now we're going to talk about Rhapsody in Blue. And Rhapsody in Blue is, it was written for piano and jazz band. It was kind of one of the first, he's the kind of pedagogic or compositional grandfather to the guy I'm going to talk about later, Kapustin, writing jazz for the concert hall. And this is probably the most famous example. It was written for piano and jazz band first, and then transcribed to piano and orchestra. And then after it was transcribed to piano and orchestra, it was transcribed to solo piano. So the piano and orchestra is the one that everyone's familiar with. And then Gershwin himself took that orchestra score and reduced it to a piano score. And so what I did was look through the score and kind of figure out different ways that Gershwin imitated the sound of a big orchestra, ways that he imitated the sound of a soloist and the kind of markings that he used to make something sound like a soloist, and then when he's playing solo piano. And so he had to take all these different elements and combine them into a piano piece. But if you play everything the same, the whole piece, and don't change the type of sound that you give each section, it's kind of boring. It's not great. So let's do a little quiz here. We can look at this page, and we have a full orchestra solo instrument or piano solo. And I'll go ahead and answer the question for you. If you look at this chord right here, it's impossible to play it all at once. Right? We have a grace note first that's held in the pedal. And so if you look at this, if I was looking at it for the first time, I would guess that it's played, it should be part of the orchestra. This guy up here is marked forte, so it's saying specifically we want this to cut through the sound. And it's articulated, right? We have staccatos, an accent, slurred. It's articulated, and this is actually a clarinet right here. And then this up here is for piano solo, because that would be a very difficult thing to orchestrate. So if you're playing this piece, this is the score for piano solo, you got to handle these things different. These notes can be more virtuosic, and even though they're fast, they can be a little bit more blurry, a little bit less pronounced. While this needs to be really pronounced. So if I was to play this, I would want that solo instrument to really cut through the texture and not be drowned out by anything else that's going on. There's a lot of seats over here. You guys can go. And if we look at this, that's exactly what happens. We have the solo piano solo instrument in the bottom, the orchestra holding this chord, and then at the top we have the solo instrument. So if we look at this, and I'm going to show you the example of the orchestral example of this. Often when we're imitating a full orchestra, the most we can do is kind of fill the span of an octave, which is exactly what he does here. This is probably as big of a sound almost as you can get on the piano. The hands are only so big. But you want to kind of fill out the harmony and play as many notes as you can to fill out the sound and imitate the sound of an orchestra. If you look at this line down here, it gets thinner, right? Now we only have a solo line, no octaves, no other notes. So in this example, we have full orchestra here, and solo instrument here, and then the piano actually plays these chords. And just to switch it up, I'll show you the recording of Bernstein playing this. So anyway, in the original score, let's go back to the PowerPoint. In the original score, we have lots of different tools and lots of different ways to get different sounds. And on the piano, we have to be a little bit more creative. We can't play the same thing the same way every time, or else it doesn't sound like an orchestra. It doesn't sound like a full score or as interesting. cool. And okay, so I think I'll take this, since we're talking about Rhapsody in Blue. I'll put a picture of Gershwin on the swing up there, and I'll play it for you. Thank you. Okay, now that I'm good and sweaty, on to the next. Okay. So the piece that I based most of my studies on, this is all Rhapsody in Blue stuff, is Capustin's Variations, which looks like this. This is the beginning and what it's based. It's based on this tune, which is a Lithuanian folk song. It's called Tu Man Susile. That's the melody. And it's actually the same melody that Stravinsky based this piece on that you might know. If you haven't heard, this is a pretty famous little opening here. Here's the Rite of Spring. So Capustin took this melody and turned it into, oh, here's the Rite of Spring. Here's a picture of the ballet for you. Turned it into this. This is the first four bars, three bars, I guess, is up of the variations, and it goes through several different keys. And most importantly, because we're talking about jazz, it swings. So it's the tune, it's there, but it's kind of hidden. And now we're going to talk a little bit more about how he imitates the sound of a large ensemble in the jazz world, which is a big band. And this is what I kind of based my argument on, is that if we talk about Beethoven and we teach Beethoven, or we teach Chopin or Liszt or any of the composers that we often teach, we teach our students to make it sound like something other than the piano. I think Scriabin said that a good piano player will make the piano sound like anything other than the piano. And so in Capustin's music, since he's kind of using a different medium, he's composing in the jazz style, I look for instances where he's imitating that of a big band. And since he had a lot of exposure, he played in Oleg Lundstrom's big band for 10 years, to the big band sound, the sounds of the trumpet section, a horn section, walking bass, all that kind of stuff is present. So the first thing that he has often is he has quarter notes played in the middle texture of the piano that imitate the drums. They're just kind of there to keep the beat. And so like in drumming, you have lots of different sounds, right? You have a snare drum, you have a hi-hat, you have cymbals. Drummers keep the beat, but they do it with a lot of different types of tones, a lot of different types of sounds. And so in this instance, he writes three staccatos, a tenuto marking, and then another staccato, right? We have a melody going on down here, a note being held up here. So if you were to orchestrate this for a big band, this would be, in my opinion, the drums. And this would be maybe a Barry sax section or something. I'll play this for you, it sounds. Right, this tenuto right here gives it a different flavor, like a different type of tone, which would maybe be taken by a cymbal or something else. Maybe snare, 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 cymbal, snare, right? All swung. Let's look at some more instances. So also, this is pretty common. This is the section that we talked about before, where we have a full ensemble sound, we have octaves played, big sounds, big chords in the left hand, and then smaller textures. In big band music, you have that as well. You'll have full band playing things, and then you'll have runs played by different instruments, like a sax playing a solo line that leads into the sound of the big band. So in this section, we have kind of the same thing going on. We have big full sound, maybe imitating the big full sound of a big band. And then we have in between them little runs, little 16th note figures that lead back into the sound of the big band. Right? right? So we have these little riffs, these little figures that might be played by a solo instrument if we were to orchestrate it for big band, whereas we have octaves and filled out, right? Fifths in the middle of the octaves to give it a big beefy sound and make it sound like a full big band. Or just more than one instrument. I mean, it could be for a smaller ensemble, it could be for a lot of different things. This is just more examples of the same type of thing, right? Big band, multiple instruments playing at once, big texture, followed by little fills that one or two instruments might play, one instrument or one section of the big band. So a really common element in jazz is something called a walking bass. Oh. So let's show you an example of that. So here's Christian McBride. He's awesome. I've seen him a couple times. So what the bass's job in a small jazz combo or a big band is to keep the beat. He plays quarter notes, da 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 da, and is kind of a constant driving force underneath the texture of the piano or the big band or whoever's playing. In Kapustin, this is one of my favorite parts of the piece. Oh, let's get back. Has that as well. If you look here in the left hand, we have constant eighth notes, right? They kind of take the place of the quarter note or whatever in a big jazz ensemble. Da 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 da. And over the top of this, we have maybe a solo instrument, sometimes multiple instruments in the big band. So just like Beethoven imitated an orchestra, Kapustin's imitating the sounds and the styles that you would find in a big band here, with a walking bass and instruments playing over it. Sounds like this. Play a little bit on, but anyway, over all that music going up on going over the top of it, right, we have this walking bass. And so if you're a pianist and you're not familiar with jazz, you might not know how to approach it. Approach something like this. But if you're familiar with big band sound, you would know that the bass has a really deep tone, I play to the bottom of I play percussively, because that's the way the bass plays. And then over the top, I play a little bit more of a glossy sound. But these accents are really important, because that in a big band sound, the accents or the strong chords of where a big band would play are very important. Okay. This is another sound that we hear a lot in Kapustin's music, comping. So comping is the job of a pianist in most all big bands. And what you do is you play chords in the middle of the keyboard in a rhythmic pattern. I'm thinking. Play chords while the melody is played by the other instruments. I'll show you what this song sounds like. Okay, And if you look in Kapustin's music, he kind of has a really similar role that the middle range of the piano will sometimes play. Right here we have a chord, and that's like, I mean, you'd play that all the time in big band charts. This type of voicing, this sound. That's a very, very common sound. And it's played by the piano, right? It's accented here. I would bring it out. But it plays a different role than this, right? This is like a low brass section or a bass, while this is a different instrument group. This is like a high alto sax section. And the role of these chords right here, and you can see they go away and then they come back, is to provide a rhythmic undertone for what's going on in the rest of the hands. A little bit of rhythmic variety. Yeah. So that chord right there is mimicking that of a piano. And I like to bring it out a little bit. Kapustin often imitates different styles. And in this piece, he imitates bop. Bop comes partly from this guy, Kenny Clarke, and is based on a two-note or a two-beat pattern. Da-da, 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 da-da. I'll show you what it... 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2. Okay. And then over that kind of two-beat pattern is often just a steady stream of eighth notes with little pockets of space in it. So this is John Coltrane's Giant Steps, which... A lot of eighth notes followed by little pockets of rests. If you look at Kapustin, the kind of finale, last notes of his, let's get back in here. The last section of this piece, we have a lot of eighth notes, quick eighth notes, sort of two-beat pattern here in the bass, very simple. Follow with eighth notes over the top. Right. A lot of eighth notes. So, in conclusion, let me get it out here. I'm going to read you a section of my paper. Einstein said, imagination is more important than knowledge. This is certainly true in piano playing. It is much easier to walk someone through the steps of learning notes and rhythm than it is to teach them to be imaginative. However, there do exist some theories that piano pedagogues can use to teach their students to imagine. And if a pianist is struggling to bring a piece to life, there are places he or she can go to get the imaginative process started. When Barenboim states, have in your ears the sound of the oboes, or the sound of the violin, or the sound of the chorus, or the sound of the flute, when speaking about Beethoven's sonatas, what does he mean? He means that in order to ignite the imagination of the different tonal possibilities of the piano, it may be helpful to be aware of the tonal possibilities of other types of instruments that Beethoven may have written for, such as the instruments in the symphony orchestra. We are all the total sum of our experiences, and we can only assume that Beethoven's experience with the orchestra, both in composing and in hearing it played, affected the way that he wrote for the piano. And if the orchestra was at times on Beethoven's mind when composing his piano sonatas, shouldn't we use the sound found in a symphony to ignite our imagination when playing the pieces he wrote for piano? Kapustin was undoubtedly exposed to and played in many types of jazz ensembles all of his professional life. We can only assume as he sat at the piano for hours on end listening to Oleg Lundstrom's jazz band rehearsed that these sounds crept into his ear and affected the way he composed. While it is also important to understand the sonata allegro form effectively to play his sonatas, the way to unwind a chosen theme to dazzle an audience with his variations, and the needed balance an orchestra must have when playing his symphonies, it is equally essential to understand the role of different instruments in a big band or jazz combo, and the different jazz styles that his compositions imply. Grigoriev, a Kapustin biographer, states, in his sonatas, symphonies, and concertos, he supplements these genres with the ideas and specifics of a jazz performance. The large-scale works are lent the rhythmic drive and inner energy of big band writing, with all the accompanying garnishes and vitality. The piano is then nearly a tool. It is an instrument used to express something and be something other than itself. As Liszt said, the piano could encompass an entire orchestra in its 7 octaves, and perhaps because of that, he thought of it as the first in the hierarchy of instruments. He is not alone. Kapustin, Liszt, Chopin, Beethoven, and countless others have used the piano as their chief means of musical expression precisely because of its limitless possibilities. It is not enough that these composers simply wrote masterpieces for the piano. It is the job of pianists to use their imagination to bring these compositions for the piano to life. Imagination is more important than knowledge. Knowledge of the content of this paper and listening to recordings of great pianists are only tools that a pianist should use to spark their imagination. Good imagination is often based on knowledge, but knowledge is only a means to an end. An intense study of big band music, small jazz ensembles, and all of the different styles of jazz should serve to ignite the imagination of pianists and listeners alike as they approach the piano compositions of Kapustin. And like anything worthwhile in any type of art or discipline, the possibilities of the imagination are endless. So this is Kapustin's Variations. Okay, so are there any questions?
So you told us about how a piano can sound as different kinds of instruments. By your opinion, even if a piano can be played with an orchestra or a band, do you think that it should still be played and sound like different kinds of instrument or how?
Sure, well, that's a good question. When you're, the idea of telling a student that a piano should sound like a different orchestra or like an orchestra or different instruments isn't necessarily to make things sound like a violin. It's to be able to create the character of the violin in different sounds. And it's also to be able to help them to separate the fact that each musical line has its own purpose and should have its own role. So that, you know, the beginning students, how to bring out a melody, how to voice the top hand. How to play with a big sound like the sound of an orchestra. So, you know, it is literal, and it's also more just a teaching tool, you know, to be able to tell someone to sound like something else other than the piano. It's to be able to create different types of tones and different sounds. Yeah.
Have you ever transcribed anything yourself?
From piano to orchestra?
The other way around.
The other way around, from orchestra to piano?
Or either way.
I wouldn't say that I've sat down and written things out, but I have put together compositions and things to play. You know, if they say, okay, we want, you know, a party or something, we want to hear this symphony. And so then I have done that before. Like, we need you to come and play this type of thing. I don't get the score, I just listen to it and figure out.
And do you have any experiences from that relate to your topic? Was there anything you learned from the transcription?
You know, I would say that in transcribing, it's not always literal. In fact, it usually isn't. You have to kind of look at what's there. There's usually such a big range of instruments and range of sounds. You have to figure out what's most important and what you want the audience to hear and then kind of bring that out. And I think with, you know, my experience with this, it's kind of the same thing. You don't want everybody to hear everything all at once. You really only want to hear one thing. If you've introduced multiple ideas at the same time, then people don't hear anything. That answers your question. Yeah?
Are there any cases in Gershwin where he changes the piano part in the solo reduction, and does he change any of the harmonies or the register? Does he ever take like a melody up an octave or anything like that?
You know, I don't think so. I think he takes the he's pretty true to the piano orchestra version, and he kind of builds around that. The piano, because it's the solo instrument, the concerto version remains kind of central to what's going on. And then you have to do things like create a pedal. You know, like I talked about to imitate the sound of the orchestra, hold sounds well. You know, he does a lot of different things as far as the orchestra goes, but I think he builds it around the piano score and it's true to the piano score.
I think he does change the piano part at the very end, though.
That's true. In the left hand, when he's imitating that, that's true. Yeah. Because the orchestra plays the thumb, and so the piano has to take that. But for the most part, maybe those big type sounds, he has a little bit more left hand action than the piano. But I think all the piano, all the original piano stuff is there for the most part. Yeah.
You've touched on a lot of my favorite pieces in the presentation here. I don't know if it's coincidental or why, but you touched upon it. This was at an exhibition, which was a prog rock piece, invention by ELP. I don't know if you've ever heard of it. And then you've touched upon Gershwin. I've never heard of Capstan.
Capstan, yeah.
Who was he?
So what is he, or what is he? He's a Ukrainian composer who kind of grew up Soviet Union times, and when Stalin died, that's kind of when he got his start, and when he left Moscow Conservatory. And he basically, he's a jazz player. He played with the orchestra for years. But he took his kind of classical background and wrote sonatas, symphonies, variations, and forms, classical forms, but took swing, jazz harmony, those types of things to compose those pieces.
What's amazing is in your presentation, you've touched upon so full variety of styles.
Yeah.
And yet you've made to blend it all in one. And like, you know, I studied piano, and people always say, well, what do you like the best? What's your best style? I said, well, I like classical, but I really love progressive rock. I wasn't really a big jazz person, but you've managed to take such a wide variety and bring it together. It's an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
You've made your teacher proud.
Thank you. Thanks. Yeah.
Talking about Houston, when he was in the conservatory, was he learning about jazz or classical music?
Yes.
There you go.
Yes. I don't think he was learning it from his teacher there. But was he learning about it? Yes.
Where did he go? Cool.
Moscow. Yeah. It's kind of like Miles Davis dropped out of Juilliard because he was in the cafe scribbling chord changes on napkins. So, yeah.
Just one thing. He came already from so-called Saint Shah. This is Moscow school. Gives training. Not the conservatory, but really quite solid.
Yeah.
And then he wrote, not himself, but he was forced to leave Moscow.
You know, and the thing, the Kapustin, I mean, it's difficult. You know, I mean, it's jazz, and it's you know, kind of this American art form take, but it's very technically challenging. And he's a great pianist because he fits all this technique in the hand very nicely. It works. Any more questions? Okay. Yes.
I was thinking about the last song.
Uh huh.
Personal interpretation to contribute to the mood and the tone of it?
So a lot of it was my, but not anything on the notes. And that's kind of what's different about Kapustin is jazz is usually improvised, right? And this is all written out. It's all very methodically planned. So I didn't add any of my own interpretation as far as the notes, but yeah, no, as far as different moods and how to play different sections and how to, yeah, that was all a huge study and a huge undertaking, even just figuring out how to interpret it. Yes?
The idea of playing a piano piece and imitating the orchestra, is that unique to Kapustin or is it common to all jazz pianists?
That's a good question. So as far as jazz pianists go, he's unique in that he writes all his stuff down. But I just kind of off the top of my head thinking about Teddy Wilson and Art Tatum and they'll imitate like a brush sound with the drums. I think stride kind of imitates that two beat pattern that you can find in different big band music. So I think that there's a case that, I haven't studied it exclusively, but I think there's a case that you could go and look at a bunch of different jazz pianists and talk about the way they separate voices, include rhythm sections in their playing, creatively, the same way Kapustin does. You could definitely make a case for that. Okay, thank you all for coming.